which is quite a slow process, and you sort of work on this DA and you sort of, you don't actually connect with the final product. So I wanted to design something that I could touch and hold, and I made it. So I decided instead of going travelling for a year, I'll go and study fashion for a year. And 1 year became 3 years and kind of happened to stop.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's really the next question. So obviously, design is a creative outlet for you. So what's the difference between being a creative and being a business person? So how do you take this creative nature and turn it into something that's quite commercial when you are servicing the needs of a much broader audience?
Yeah, it's quite hard. It's I think it's, well, this is my only experience in fashion design, but I feel like especially in fashion design, it's a very business, creative business. So we ended up spending 4 weeks of the year actually designing and being creative, and the rest of the time is just running our business. So it was an extremely hard shift into trying to be this putting on your business. And you don't actually get to be that creative. So it was quite a hard transition, but it was a really.
I don't think we've ever prioritised the business side of it. We've probably always prioritised the creative side of it. Just like things like having two labels is really bad marketing. So we've always kind of tried to put the design or the creative side in front of. Which is probably not great business.
So
we've just trusted that if we think our designing is good, then someone else has got it. Hopefully they're out there thinking it's of some value as well. So if you really try to have integrity in what you're doing, then hopefully back in will come with you, which I mean we've had to learn a lot in the process, but I think that's been our general philosophy starts having organic growth. I think it's been quite good for us because then it's, you know, it's when we're ready to make a decision, that's when we change as opposed to kind of forcing us.
So the fashion industry is quite fickle at any level. So how do you decide who you're going to design for? And how did you decide to promote yourself to those particular purchases of fashion?
We were trying to work out how we would work creatively. We developed a system where we would try garments on, and if we thought it suited us, then that would be that's our point of kind of judgment. So having that has always helped because it's, that's where we get our integrity at that time.
Yeah. And I guess you do. Like at CIT, you do market research and things like that, and you kind of have an idea of who is your target market, but we don't follow trends, we don't design for this is the only person who can wear our clothes. It's sort of, we look a lot at Japanese designers that have, like, there's not sort of age specifics necessarily or body specifics, so it's kind of, you know, quite an organic way. Not trying to go too far out with our design. pushed us into designing for a more specific person target life, I think, and now that we're getting this feedback directly from the customer, it's quite a different experience too. So that, I mean, just having that direct contact has been the best research we've ever had.
So what made you make that decision to go into retail? Well, it's certainly not the easiest retail environment right now. So what made you make that final decision?
We think wholesaling, so we really fell into starting the business as well straight away. So after when we graduated, one of our teachers sort of said, there's this thing you should apply for. It's Fashion Expos, which is a national trade show. This is the debut section of it, so it's for graduates. And we just did whatever our teachers told us to. So we applied, we got in, and we won debut designer for that season, which then gave us a bigger stand at the next trade show. And people just started ordering. We didn't have prices on anything. We were completely unprepared. So it was a very, very frantic beginning to our play. And so we stumbled, we've been wholesaling for 5 years, but with no real plan. It's just been happening. And it's been getting harder and harder. So boutiques have been closing or changing direction, or wholesaling in Australia, I think, is just hard in itself. It's such a huge country. There's not that many independent boutiques, and especially for sort of our market, maybe. It's, so it was getting increasingly harder. And then we actually did a market in Canberra, which was our first direct access to the customer. And it just gave us we were at the stage of, how long can we keep doing this? We don't make any money. We're just in the studio all day, basically, cutting. We don't see our pieces on anybody. We see each other in the fabric, and it's becoming very sort of uninspiring. And after that month, I think we both got a real rush of people wanted to buy our clothes and wanted to, express how much they liked our stuff. And that was just such a huge revelation to us to have that feedback. We needed a change. And the opportunity came up. The woman who we are in business with, who was looking for a space for a couple of years, she was offered a space and offered the half of it with us. And it sort of all just happened at the right time.
It was on the back of the burner slightly, but we had the notebooks and masks that we kind of started to decide that that was a good one.
Well, congratulations on starting. Here's the idea. It's my final question for me. I mean, Canberra doesn't have the greatest reputation as being a creative hub. So why did you decide to stay in Canberra? And what do you see as the advantages and maybe disadvantages of being in Canberra as young fashion designers?
It's a great place to be creative because you don't have a lot of distractions. So I probably go and see a lot of things, but I wouldn't actually make anything for myself, I suspect. So I think that's... And there are a lot of great exhibitions, and there's a lot going on in Canberra.
I think we probably stayed because it was... we both had ties to Canberra, so I lived here with my partner, and we started to really working, and we had a great opportunity from CIT. They supported us hugely, so we were in a graduate studio at CIT, which was... You just wouldn't get... If we moved to Sydney, it becomes... You're just shifting your whole life. And with fashion, when we were doing trade shows, we had to travel anyway because the trade shows moved. So we wouldn't have just been able to stay in Sydney, and that is, you don't have to travel. So Canberra, aside from the fact that we can't get any supplies here, we have to go to Sydney for fabrics, but then that's a fun thing to do anyway. We get to go and experience that little hub of something exciting, and then get to come back to Canberra and be in our bubble. And Canberra is also no one thinks that anything happens here, so it kind of gave us a point of difference as well. People were like, oh, you're from Melbourne. And I'm like, no, I'm from Canberra. And they're like, oh, okay, Canberra. In fashion. So it was kind of like, it was kind of an interesting place to be. And Canberra is now, it is hugely creative. And so there's great creative courses here, but then I think people had to disperse because there's not a lot of industry here, but people are starting to stay now. So fashion is huge in Canberra now. It's like all of our friends have labels and are doing stuff, training for
before I move on to the next conversation, does anybody have any questions of Jen and Francesca about their journey?
Yes, what is the name of your business from?
So 4 minutes 33 is a reference to the John Cage composition, which is 4 minutes 33 seconds of silence. So I guess we were looking within our labels, within our designing, we look a lot at a Japanese author, Haruki Murakami, a filmmaker Wong Kar-wai, and a photographer Yamamoto Maseo. So we've always sort of looked at the concepts of space and a bracket of time and this kind of personal observation. So when we were trying to combine, we were it took us ages, like 6 months, to we were going through names and we really sort of wanted something that represented this idea of this kind of space and all these day three sort of something like that.
Did you actually start off as a business from the go, or was there a transition period from sort of a hobby that started to make money into we need to register?
We went straight into the business, which I think is why we were so, we were like, oh, someone wants our pot. It's like, I don't know. We're sort of started always on the back foot, and that we didn't really know what we were doing. So you say yes to someone, and then you'd be like, oh God, now I've got to figure out how you do this.
It wasn't an intentional business though, so we didn't know before we took, you know, we weren't like, oh, if someone wants to order our stuff, we better set up our business and let's go and set up GST and our tax and all that. We were like, you know, in and we were like, oh, done by the tax office, we've got to set up and stuff. So it was running as a business, but yeah, we weren't very good at setting it up as a business.
And as you've progressed in, you're finding that there are things now that you wish you'd done differently in that setup process, or are you having to go back and change?
You did anything particularly that drastically badly? Like, I think it really has been, as we're ready to, like, it has been organic growth, so we're kind of, I don't know, we've sorted it out.
It was quite interesting, we taught about the third year students at CIT their business courses last year, and it's, you know, we're teaching them this is the steps, this is how you do everything, and we're like, this is totally not what we've started this end. But I don't think, even if you know all of the steps, you never get it exactly what you want, and I think it's nice to not do it that way because you learn a lot from, like, it was huge that first year, or the last 5 years, it's been such a massive and organically growing, and this kind of naive need to say yes to everything was what gave us a lot of the opportunities. If we kind of stopped and thought about it for a second, I think we would have just ran away. So it was kind of, yeah, it's, I don't think you ever do things properly or most of the time anyway.
You'll have a chance, sorry. We might just move on. I might just get maybe we can sort of question like that. I know that. Do you have a question?
Sorry. How do you manage your manufacturer? Not making everything yourself.
Manufacturing is really hard. It's very just small label. I'm sure it's hard to do it for small restaurants, but we tried a few different things. So at the moment, we cut everything ourselves, which is hugely time consuming. And then we have machines to ordering. We've been working for the last 5 years, so she just drove from home. We tried a factory in Sydney, and we tried we had two machines at the same time. But
production is an ongoing battle. Like, we never found the perfect solution, and there probably isn't a perfect solution. So it's, I guess, trying to balance what we want at that time and how we can kind of get the best results. And the shop is kind of a different production level to what we're doing prior to that. So it's, you know, finding happy and everything is problem solving. So it's just, there's always an issue with, I don't know, with whatever it is, and then you just, how do you find a solution? And it's not always the best, I mean, it's the best solution, it's not the perfect solution.
It's definitely an issue. It's an issue that we have with all our small manufacturers in Australia. Just doing small runs is incredibly expensive here in Australia. We these girls have come up with really clever solutions. We'll take one last question, and then there'll be an opportunity to chat with Gemma and Francesca when we get together after the session. We have one last question.
Yeah, I was just interested in your saying that you go to trade fairs in the beginning. You're not going to orders, and then you travel around to a few trade shows, and then you said also in the car, and I was just wondering what happened. Is it something like trade fairs were working? So when we started the trade show, it was 2009, the beginning of 2009, and it was just before the financial crisis hit, and the people were just, and the train shows also went on a downhill as well. So when we first started the train show, it was a lot of independent designers was showing there. And it was, there were a lot of buyers from not just Australia but New Zealand and sort of quite interesting places as well. And then the train show sort of really went downhill and became about sort of mass production in China as well. So it was, we started sort of at a great point, and very quickly it all kind of changed, and not necessarily for the worse, but for us it was became really hard.
Mm-hmm. I might just wrap that up, but you know, I guess that's a lesson that we try and spread with all of our people that we work with, is that business is never linear. It's about as circular as you can get, and you keep going around in circles for many, many years. But please join me in thanking